you bring my voice down and play those modern? Can you hear my guitar a little bit? Thank you. up here, but that's okay. You know, I love that song. I ain't gonna get choked up like I did last week. But there is something in that song that I love. The cry of my heart is to bring you praise, and it talks about how God is the light. And you know, the definition of darkness is the absence of light. And so when we don't have that light in our life, and we're not doing the things that God has us to do, and we're not carrying out His will, and we're not living the way that He would have us to live, then the light's not in us, right? And that's why God calls us to be the light of the world. That's why it's so important that we stay true to what we really are, and we stay true to the relationship that we have with Christ, so that we do have that light, and we're able to shine that light, and we're able to be that light. So something that I've kind of gone through in my own life in the last few weeks is realizing that when we feel that we're separate from God and we feel like we're in the darkness and the light isn't there, it's not because God went anywhere, right? Because God is who God is and He doesn't change. It's us that we change, and the things change in our heart, and we start to move away from the light. And that's when we start to have darkness in our life, and when things start to affect us in a way that aren't good, is because that we've left the light. The light, you know, is Christ in us. So it's so important that we stay true to who God is to us. So, let's sing one more song. I just want to increase that. I just want to sing. Speaks this morning, God, and that He would just bring a word that would touch us, God, and that would change our lives. We just pray these things in your name. Amen.
You may be seated. Good morning, and welcome to New Hope Baptist Church. We are delighted to have you here this morning. If you are visiting with us for the first time, I am Scott, the assistant pastor here at New Hope, and we just are delighted that you're here. And there is a guest registration form that you can find inside your bulletin. And if you wouldn't mind filling that out, we can have a record of your visit, and we would so much appreciate that. Also, you will find on the other side of that registration form and on the orange cards, you may have gotten an orange card in your bulletin, and there's two opportunities there for you to sign up to get a t-shirt, a New Hope t-shirt. This is the last day that we'll be taking orders for that, as well as signing up if you can help in some way at the Fall Fest, and we'll contact you about that and schedule a time that you can do that. And so if you wouldn't mind letting us know, if you could operate a game booth or help with setup or tear down or whatever the case may be concerning the Fall Fest, that is a big community outreach ministry for us. That will be Saturday, October the 29th at Orr City at the park. And so we always have a good time and a lot of ministry opportunity there. And I just want to give you a moment to fill those out if you'd like to do that. We're going to have you put that in the offering plate in just a few minutes instead of at the end of the service as per usual. So take time to do that. And as the gentlemen come, I'll mention to you the several things going on that you can see there in your bulletin, church-wide things coming up. The Fall Fest, we have the fifth Sunday singing, the last Sunday night of this month. If you sing, your family sings, or you play an instrument and you'd like to do that and share that with us, Sunday afternoon, October the 30th, we invite you to do that. Just get with me and let me know. So on that Sunday, we're going to have a light potluck lunch after the morning service, just kind of soup, sandwiches, chips kind of a thing. And then following that service, we'll have an afternoon praise and testimony service. So if you want to share some music, share a testimony, something that the Lord has done in your life, we encourage you to do that. We give you the opportunity to do that at that time, so just let me know. And then, of course, coming up next month, be in prayer about our revival with evangelist Dennis Irwin and the Irwin Family Quartet. They'll be here, and I know that they will be a blessing to you, and you won't want to miss one night of that. It's not very long, just Sunday night through Wednesday night. So a lot of things going on, a lot of ways to get involved, and if we can help you in any way, we want to do that. So let's ask our blessing, if we could, then, upon our offering this morning. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege that we have of giving back to you. We thank you that you supply our needs, and that you watch over us, and Lord, your goodness to us, your kindness. And we ask, Lord, that you would guide and direct in all that takes place in this service, that it would honor and glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. she would come at this time. She's going to share a song with us. But as she's coming, we will dismiss Children's Church. Children's Church, you may be dismissed. If you haven't been to Children's Church before, it's through this door at the back corner to my left. And you moms and dads are welcome to go back there if you want to see where they're going and what they're doing. Amen. If you want to go help Miss Dina in Children's Church, looks like that would be awesome. So, praise the Lord. All right, Miss Dina.
Last Sunday, Brother Tony quoted a poem during his message, and I thought, I know that. And after the service, I said, I learned that song when I was a kid. So I searched through my archives and through his archives, and we located it. So I'm going to sing the song, Others.
Something I can do. Two, I just enjoy preaching. Just how it is. It's easy to talk about somebody you love. And I just love the Lord, love to talk about the Lord. However, every once in a while in your life, you're able to run across somebody who is just an inspiration to you and an inspiration just to your Christian life. And I ask people sometimes to say, in your Christian life, how many people do you know who you could say, if I was going to live the Christian life, I would want to live the Christian life like that person. There's somebody who I wouldn't mind modeling my Christian life after. And when I first met Dr. Miss P, and we call him Dr. Miss P because his name is Paramanandam, and if you want to try to remember that, you can do that. But anyway, Dr. P will do. And when I first met him and heard him talk about the ministry there in India, I thought, they do not do all that in India. And heard his testimony. I was so impressed with his testimony. And But I thought, you know, if that's really what they do, we need to see. And went over there, and Dr. P and his wife, they are the real deal. And I'm going to tell you some things about their ministry a little bit later on that they're not going to tell you. But when they come up today, I just want you to know that I'm yielding this pulpit over because I believe in them and what God is doing through them, and I believe in what they're doing in India. And I think it just does us good to see somebody who they're really living for the Lord, and not just living for the Lord, they're living for the Lord a great sacrifice to themselves. And that is, to me, just very, very inspirational. So, Dr. P, if you would come on, it is good to have them. Y'all welcome them this morning.
Hallelujah. I like to sing a song again because I never knew that Jesus Christ is the God. Once I was worshipped many gods, I was worshipping many idols. By the grace of God, God saved me from the bondage of the sins. Now I know that Jesus Christ is the God. He is the risen God.
Will come is great. So you people, you can also sing with us. Yeah.
Hallelujah, Hosanna, Hallelujah, Hosanna,
great, big, wonderful God we have. I never knew this before. Because I was a Hindu. As a Hindu, I used to worship many Hindu gods. But I never knew Jesus Christ is true God. I worshipped all the Hindu gods. I was not satisfied. The reason why I worshipped all the Hindu gods, I wanted to get rid of from my sins. I wanted to go to heaven when I die. No God delivered me from the bondage of my sins. When I read about Hindu gods, I read Hindu gods, they themselves are living in sin. When I read about Hindu gods are stealing, Hindu gods are lying, Hindu gods are having, they are fighting each other, Hindu gods are having many wives. So I started thinking, what is this? God means God must be holy. But the gods I am worshipping, they are living in sin. So I decided, these gods are not true gods. There must be only one God who is holy and is able to deliver me from the bondage of my sins. And I must find out that true holy one of God. So it was a great desire in my heart. And I was sincerely seeking after true God. I started reading many religious books. Still I was not able to find out any true God. Finally someone gave me the Bible. When I got the Bible, I started reading from Genesis. Even while I was reading the Bible, it was so interesting to read. I had enough time to read the Bible because I just finished my 10th grade and having 2 months summer vacation. So I had enough time to read the Bible. I was going on reading this Bible day and night. While I was reading the Bible, I felt God was speaking to me. It was quite different from all the other books I ever read. I read the whole Bible within 2 months. When I read the Bible, I came to a conclusion that Jesus Christ is true God. Praise God. Still, I was not saved at that time. I read the whole Bible. I found Jesus Christ is true God. Still, I was not saved. That was the time my father was suffering from throat cancer and was having, he was not able to speak for many days. And at the time, some group of people, Christians, came to my house and prayed for my father. When they prayed, instantly a kind of breath and fuss came out from my father's mouth and started speaking. My father confessed, oh, now I am speaking. Jesus Christ is true God. My father told, let's all take baptism. It was in 1966. 9 of us took baptism. My father, my mother, my brothers, my sister, my grandmother, all 9 of us took baptism in 1966, January on the 1st. Still we were not saved. Still I was not saved. Because nobody told us about salvation. I did not know the way of salvation. It was 1969. A man of God from America, Mr. Hubert Mitchell, came to India and preached the gospel message in my city. When he preached, he played accordion and sang songs and preached the gospel message. When he preached, God spoke to me and convicted of my sins. When he gave out the call, I raised my hand and went to the front. I knelt down and confessed my sins with the tears. I wept like a child for my sins. When I got up from my kneeling, I had a great joy of salvation. I got assurance that Jesus Christ has forgiven my sins and coming to my heart. It happened in 1969, December on the 7th, on Sunday by 2 p.m., Jesus saved me. From that day onward, I am not able to keep quiet. I started sharing about my salvation experience to others. Then my parents got saved, my brother and sister all got saved. Then in 1972, God called me to do his ministry full time. When God called me, I quit my, at the time I was doing my business. I was manufacturing, packing materials and supplying to some companies and earning a lot of money in that business. That was the time God called me to do his ministry full time. When God called me, I quit my business. Then in 1973, I went to the Bible college. I studied 5 years. I was graduated in 1978. Right after my graduation, my parents arranged my marriage. Many times, many people are wondering, how is it possible to arrange marriage? It is possible. It is good. It's a blessing. Oh, actually, in the month of April 1978, on the 11th, I was graduated from the Bible college. Actually, before that, my parents were looking for a girl to arrange marriage for me. And at the time, I was invited to preach in a church. While I was preaching in that church, this girl was sitting in that church. While I was preaching, I felt God was telling me to get married this girl. But what to do? In India, we are not supposed to talk to each other before marriage. So I just prayed to God, God, if it is your will that I must get married this girl, I am not going to talk to her. I am not going to tell it to anyone. If it is your will that I must get married this girl, let my parents arrange this girl. I just prayed to God and left it. I did not tell it to anyone, not even to my parents. After Sunday, my parents took me to one girl's house, not this girl, another girl. When my parents took me to that girl's house, when we went there, that was another girl. So I told no to my parents. See, we have right to say, both boy and girl have right to say yes or no. They will arrange that marriage only when we say yes. When we say no, then they will look for another girl. So, after Sundays, my parents took me to this girl's house. When we went there, when I saw this girl, I was so happy. Then my wife's parents were sitting, parents, brothers, sisters, all were sitting in that house. My parents and took me there. And while we were sitting there, I asked two questions. Very first question I asked this girl whether she is saved or not. She never opened her mouth. But her mother said, yes. The second question I asked this girl whether she is willing to get married me or not. Again, she never opened her mouth. Her mother said, yes. Then I said yes to my parents. So my parents arranged. We got married on the 13th of April, 1978. Right after my marriage, we started preaching the gospel in the streets. I play accordion, my wife sings songs in the streets. Through street preaching, some Hindus got saved. We told them to come to my house. So 12 people came to my house. With those 12 people, we started our first worship service in my house in 1978, December, on the 10th. And we named the church Calvary Baptist Church. Day by day, many Hindus were getting saved and started coming to my house, then there was no more space to sit in my house. So we bought a piece of land and we put a small tank in front, coconut leaves on the top, and we were worshipping in it. In 1992, we built a small church building. Now 200 people are coming to the church.
Amen.
Praise God, glory to God. In 1997, God gave me vision to plant 1,000 churches in all over India. So, we started preaching the gospel in the street, but we cannot go everywhere and preach the gospel because we don't know their languages. We have 1,600 languages in India. Even I don't know my wife's language. My wife speaks Malayalam language, I speak Tamil language. I don't know my wife's language. But she knows my language because she went to school in my language. So we have 1,600 languages. So in 1998, we started Calvary Baptist Bible College. We take committed young Christians from all over India who speak different languages. But we teach in English because all the students know English. We are providing free food and accommodation for 3 years course, Bachelor of Theology, BTH. When they are graduated, then we are sending them back to their own places from where they have come to preach the gospel in their own languages and to plant churches where there is no church. In this way, by the grace of God, so far we have planted 139 churches. Pastor Tony Pierce came to India 2 times, last year and this year, planted 2 more new churches.
Man.
So total we have 139 churches now. So Hindus are very good people, they are religious people, they are very receptive to the gospel, they are very hungry for God, they don't know who is true God. That's why they are worshipping many gods. When we preach about Christ, then they realize this is the true God whom we are seeking for. So Hindus are very receptive to the gospel. When Pastor Tony came, I took him to the new village where there's no church, no Christians. All were Hindus. I asked him to preach the gospel. He preached. Through his preaching, some Hindus got saved. So we started a church. This year also we did the same. So, 2 more new churches. Please, you can also come to India. If you come to India, I will take you to new village. There are so many thousands of Hindu villages. Hindus are very good people. They are morally, they are very good. But they don't know who is true God. If you come to India, I will take you that kind of places and ask you, share about your testimony. How you got saved, and you can share the gospel. Through your sharing, we can plant a church. So, you are most welcome to come to India and plant churches. So, in India, fields are ready for harvest. We have to go and preach and plant churches. That's all. People are ready to receive Christ. So, please pray for these things. And also, this year, when Pastor Tony came to India, this year we started, in the month of July, we started the Bible College. We reopened our Bible College on the 7th of July. So, please pray for this also. So, many students are ready to come to our Bible College, but we are finding financial problem. We are not able to take all of them because we have to provide free food and accommodation for the students. So please pray for these things. So now I'd like to give not brief message from Numbers chapter 12, verses 1 to 16. In this chapter, we read about Moses is facing a problem. Moses facing a problem, opposition, even from his own brother and sister. The Bible says in Numbers chapter 12, verse 1, we read, and Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. Miriam was a sister of Moses. Aaron was a brother of Moses. They started speaking against to Moses. Against Moses. So, he did not do anything. He never got angry with them. He just kept quiet. But God took action. Because of that, Miriam became a leprous. Then Moses prayed for her. Then God, after 7 days, Miriam was healed. See? So here in this chapter, I'd like to speak on the topic, three noble characters found in the life of Moses. The three noble characters of Moses, the man of God. So, it is always good to learn some good things from some good people. So we find three noble characters in this chapter, Numbers 12th chapter. So number one is meekness. What is the opposite word for meekness? What is the opposite word for meekness?
Pride.
Okay, you can say anything. opposite word. Maybe I can say angry. Okay? Yeah. So, when Moses was facing this problem, and Miriam and Aaron speaking against Moses, Moses did not get angry with them. But the Bible says in verse 3, says, Numbers 12, verse 3, now the man Moses was very meek above all the men which were upon the face of the earth. Bible says Moses was very meek. So, when somebody is speaking against us, how do we feel? Are we happy about it, or are we getting angry about it, or meek? So, the number one character found in the life of Moses was meekness. Many times we are getting angry. My father used to tell me, while we were yet Hindus, quite often my father used to tell me, my son, Don't get angry. You are angry will kill you. Angry will spoil our life. So, let's have this meekness in our life. So here it says, Matthew's Gospel chapter 5 verse 5 says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. In other words, if we are weak, then we will be blessed. So, if you are getting angry, we will be cursed. We'll be spoiled. We will lose our peace. So, when we are meek, then we will be blessed. So, let us search ourselves. How many times do we get angry? With whom we are getting angry? People are getting angry with the wife, with husband, with the children, with parents, with brothers, with the fellow workers. Many times people are getting angry. Definitely it will bring curse upon us. But when we are weak, then God will bless us. That's what Jesus said. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. That means we will be blessed if we are meek. So, 1 Peter 3, 4 says, but let it be the hidden man of the earth, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God, of great price. Which one is a great price in the sight of God? Which is a great price in the sight of God? Meekness. It's just like an ornament. When people are wearing ornament, they look beautiful. Even if we ladies, in our early age, we had to purchase a land. At that time we had no money. My wife gave all her ornaments, all her jewels, to sell it and buy the property of our church building, for our church building. When she removed all the ornaments, she was looking like a man. She was not looking for beauty. See, now she is looking very pretty. She is beautiful. So, when we are wearing any ornament, it looks beautiful. So, when we are able to see everything the same way, if you are wearing meekness in our life, it looks so beautiful. It is the great price in the sight of God. So, let's all have this meekness. Get away from the angry. Philippians 4:5 says, let your meekness be known to all men. Number two, faithfulness. The second noble character found in the life of Moses was faithfulness. He was faithful everywhere. What is the opposite word for this? Unfaithful. Not being honest. Moses was faithful in all his life. in his ministry. Bible says, Numbers 12:7 says, "My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all my house." What a great testimony from God Himself. So we must also have this good testimony. We must be faithful everywhere, in all things. We must be faithful in our family life, in our marriage. You must be faithful to your wife, faithful to your husband. You must be faithful in everywhere where you work. So, my wife, my father, every time, even while we were yet Hindus, my father used to tell me, "Be faithful. Don't tell lie for anything. Be honest all the time." My father used to tell me this word while we were yet Hindus. So, my father never told any lie. My father told, "Lie is a poison. Don't tell lie for anything." Even from my boyhood, my father told me this, taught me this thing. Still, I am maintaining. I don't tell lie for anything, at any time, for anything. Even I am going to get millions of dollars by telling just one lie, I am not telling. I don't want to tell any lie. We must be honest. That's not, because that's not God's way. Two ways we can get money. Being honest, faithful, we are getting money, means that is God's way. We can also get money by telling lies and dishonest. That's the devil's way. We must be honest, faithful in everything, even my wife. My wife, she was working in the commercial tax office department. She was a big officer. She was deputy commercial tax officer in her office. In India, bribery is very common. If she wanted to receive bribe every day she would have received at least $200 every day. But she never got any bribe in her office. Because of that, she had very good testimony. Getting bribery. It's not God's way. So, we must be faithful, honest, everywhere. Here, people were creating problems. Yes, Moses' brother and sister, Miriam and Aaron, were speaking against Moses. What was the reason? Because Moses got married an Ethiopian woman. What was their intention? I think by speaking against them, they wanted to divorce Moses' wife and get married Israel. But God did not tell like that. God did not tell like that. God did not say, "Oh Moses, yes, what Miriam and Aaron are telling is right. Yo, you divorce your wife and get married another Israelite woman." God never told like that. Once married, it is one for all. Some people there say, "Oh, I got, I, I made a mistake in my first marriage. So I'm going to divorce her and I'm going to get married another. No, that is not right. Once married, it's once for all. Here, they were creating problem, but he never spoke against them, against them. He was faithful, Moses was faithful. Bible says, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, verse 21. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. And thou into the joy of, enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. So, if you are faithful in a few things, then God will make us ruler over many things. That means God will give us promotion. God will bless us. And so we should not be unfaithful. When we are faithful, then God will bless us. God will honor us. So, Moses was faithful in his life. The third noble character found in the life of Moses was, he was loving even enemies. These people were talking against Moses. Still, Moses loved them and prayed for her leprosy to be healed. He loved even enemies. This is what God expects us to do. Even here, we read Numbers 12, 13, verse 13, we read, and Moses cried unto the Lord, saying, heal thy now, O God, I beseech thee. See, this is what Jesus said in Matthew's Gospel 5:44. Read, but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Jesus said, love your enemies. And also he said, pray for them. Pray for your enemies. Do we do like this? Are we loving your enemies? Are you praying for your enemies? Many times, we don't pray for the enemies. We pray for our own families. We are praying for our own things. We are praying for our loved ones. But we don't pray for the enemies. But Jesus taught us, pray for the enemy, for your enemy. That's what Moses did. Moses prayed for his enemy. So, make a list. How many enemies you have? Pray for them. Love them. Do you know the secret? If you pray for your enemy, then you will be able to love them. You just try to pray for them. Then you will be able to love them. So, Jesus told, follow me. Follow me. Jesus himself, he not only taught, but also he practiced. When Jesus was on the cross, Jesus prayed for his enemies who crucified him. As a believers, born again, children of God, we are supposed to follow these good, noble characters. So, Bible says, Romans 12:14, bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Romans 12:19, dearly beloved, avenge not yourself, but rather give place unto wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. So, if somebody is doing anything against you, don't get angry with them. Don't try to do something against them. If you try to do something, then God will keep quiet. If you keep quiet, then God will take action. Don't try to take any action. Just keep quiet. See, even when I was preaching the gospel in the streets, one day when I was preaching, we went as a team, some young people were with me, and I was playing accordion. We were singing songs. At the time, a group of Hindu people, they were a priestly family, they came and started shouting, stop, stop, stop singing, don't preach Christ here. We never stopped. We were keep on singing. You know what they did? They took the Coleman lamp we had, they put down and broke it. Then they took the megaphone we had, they put it, they took it and put down and broke it. Then they took the single drum beat we were beating, they put down and broke it. Then they took all the gospel portions we had, they threw them away. Then they tried to break my accordion also, because the accordion was tied with the belt. They were pulling, but they were not able to pull it. Because of all these problems, there were about 200 people gathered. We did not do anything against them. They were keep on going on doing something bad against us, but we did not do anything against them. We just kept quiet. Then God took action. The people, Hindus, who were gathered there, they themselves caught these young people and beat them. They ran away, still they got 3 of them. And they told us, sir, let's go to the police station and give complaint. I told them, sir, we don't want to go to the police station. You just leave them. They left them, they ran away. Then the other Hindus gathered, they asked us, sir, you preach about Christ. We preach the gospel. That day 15 people got saved. Amen. Praise the Lord. Just keep quiet. If anybody is doing anything wrong, anything against you, don't try to do anything against them. Just keep quiet. God will take action. So, here, Bible says in Romans 12:20, therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. So, the Bible teaches to have these 3 noble characters: meekness, faithfulness, loving enemies. Do we have these noble characters with us? Are you wearing these noble characters in our life? How did Moses get all these noble characters? Was Moses originally meek man? No. Do you remember when he was in Egypt where an Egyptian was beating a Hebrew. You know what did Moses do? He killed the Egyptian and buried him. Then how Moses got all this noble character? When God met him, his life was changed. Not only that, but also he won. Again and again, he read Exodus, the book of Exodus, if you read how many times he climbed the mountain. Moses climbed the mountain, came down to the earth. Climbed the mountain and came down from the mountain. Quite often we read, when Moses climbed up to the mountain, he spent time with the Lord. That's why his life was changed. That's the way he got these three noble characters. So, Moses' life was changed. And so, we must also do the same. We must also spend much time with the Lord in prayer and meditating on the Word of God. In Bible says, in Acts chapter 17, verse 11, would you please, any one of you, read it? Acts chapter 17, verse 11. Would you please, any one of you, stand up and read this verse? Acts, book of Acts, chapter 7, verse 11. Who's going to read? Any one of you, please stand up and read it. Okay.
Acts 7:11?
Yes. 17:11. Chapter 17, verse 11.
These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searching the scriptures daily, whether those things were so.
So, thank you, brother. So, when we meditate on the Word of God, we will have these noble characters. It will not come out of a sudden. Every day, while we are going on reading this Bible, meditating on this Word, and spending time with the Lord, I am sharing this from my experience. Every day, while I was reading this Bible and meditating on the Word of God and spending time in prayer, my life is being changed. So, Moses also, even when he met God, all of a sudden his life was not changed. Even in Exodus, we read when he went up to the mountain Sinai and we got the devil's Ten Commandments, when he came down after receiving that thing, and the people were worshipping idol worship, and when he got, and at the time also, he got angry. Moses got angry. And he threw the tables and broke it into pieces. And also, he broke the golden calf and made it, ground it into pieces. Powder and put it in the water and put their heads and made them to drink it. Such an angry man he was. Still he was an angry man. But when we came to the Numbers, and then his life was completely changed. God himself testified. Moses was the meekest man. He was very meek. The whole year. So, that's all. Spend time with the Lord. Take time to pray and meditate on the Word of God. Then our life will be changed. May God bless you.
Amen. Let's all stand together and let me have the musicians come. If you need to make a decision, we always want to give you time to do that. And musicians will come. And we really appreciate having Dr. P and what he does there in India and what he does when he comes to the States. If you need to make some sort of decision today, this altar is open. Feel free to do that. As the musicians sing, you